So day 15, grade 11 pre-cal. Tomorrow's just catch-up day. I guess there's other reasons why folks won't be here. Kids have the day off in public school, example. Test, right? And we never did get around to graphing sine graphs, right? So I decided to do a warm-up, which turned into being the entire day. And the warm-up involved everything. Well, I thought I would copy and paste a whole bunch of problems from your assignments, because very few people actually seem to be getting into this Unit D sequences stuff. So let's have a look at what we did. I admit that Unit D is kind of tough. So here's the first question. Given the first term and the common difference, find, one, the first five terms, and then two, the explicit formula. Right, so I tell you the terms are, the first term is negative 38, and the common difference is negative 100. So what that means is, you're starting with a negative 38, and every time you take one step to the right, you drop 100. So, pretty difficult to calculate that, eh? Gee, wonder what's next? Negative 338. There you go. So you just keep subtracting 100 until you get to the end, if you know where the end is, right? Let me pause this moment. All right, until you get where the end is. So you got a magic formula for that that says any term is equal to the first term plus the n minus 1 times the common difference, all right, where n is the term number you're going to. Now, that's the arithmetic formula. That's the general arithmetic formula. Now, of course, we're doing a specific thing, so we know the first term is negative 38, and we know the d is negative 100, so we could make it a little more specific, this formula. So you could tell your friend, oh, if you want to know for this particular one, the any term is negative 38 plus n minus 1 times negative 100. And they go, come on, that's us. Why would you tell me something that confusing? Can't you make it easier to understand? So, of course, what you would do is you're going to multiply this 100 inside, distribute it inside the brackets there, and tidy it up a bit. All right, notice the negative 38 and 100 would combine to make a 62, and then you'd subtract 100 n's. So now you could tell your buddy, there's the formula to calculate any term in the series, in the sequence, right? You take 62 and you subtract 100 n's. That's a little easier to understand than negative 38 and then add 1 less than the n times negative 100. Turns out this is a little easier to understand, all right? So there's the secret formula. All right, you got her. Next slide. So here's the new formula. You're told the first term, this time I'll use A instead of T. Some websites use A, some websites use T. I don't know why the A is there. I call it a term. So you know that the common difference is 4. So that means every time you take one step to the right or hop one lily pad, you add another 4 to the last lily pad. So 39, 43, 47, pretty difficult. And it would go on and on, just like that. But the question is, what is the last term going to be? So if you want to know the formula for any term, of course it's an arithmetic series, an arithmetic sequence rather. Right? A series is when they're added together. So an arithmetic progression or an arithmetic sequence, as we call it. The nth term is the first term plus n less 1 times the common difference. That's the general formula for all arithmetic series, or sequences, rather. All right, now, in our particular case, we know we started with an A, or an A1, of 35, and we took that many of steps. So if you, to get to the nth lily pad, you took n minus 1 steps to get there, times 4. So you could say there's the secret formula to calculate our particular arithmetic sequence. And then your buddy says, well, come on, that's pretty complicated. Can't you tidy that up a bit? And you say, sure, it's really 35 plus 4 n's minus 4. If you multiply that 4 inside using the distributive law. So you could tidy it up and say it's really 31 plus 4 n's. All right. So the other way to calculate that is you take 31 and add 4 times the lily pad number. So, right, so 31 plus 4 1's, boom, 35. 31 plus 2 1s, boom, plus 2 4s, 39. 31 plus 3 4s, boom, 43. Right, so it does work out. So this is the easier version of that. People would understand what you were saying with this. They wouldn't understand when you say the n minus 1th term. All right, next slide. Engage. So evaluate means to calculate a number. That's why it's got the word value in it. And we're going to add up all these terms. That's what a series is. A series is a sequence, but all the terms are added together. So I'm telling you the first term is 42, the last term is 146, and there's 14 terms. So I'm not going to bother writing them all out. But notice I do draw out what I'm doing, right? I put 14 little lily pads there. I mean, if there's too many, I don't put them all. But there was 14 lily pads. The first lily pad had 42 flies on it. The second lily pad had 146 flies on it. And you're going to hop to every one of those lily pads, starting at the first one, and you're going to eat all the flies. So you're going to eat 42 flies, and then you're going to hop to the next one and eat some more flies until you get to the last lily pad, and you eat 146 flies on the last lily pad. So, how many flies did you eat? Well, there's a secret formula for that. Turns out the sum of all of those numbers, when you add them together, is the number of lily pads divided by 2 times the first term plus the last term. And that's the general formula. Let's plug in what we know. So we had 14 lily pads, or 14 places, 14 numbers, divided by 2. The first number was 42. The last number was 146. That sounds like 188 to me. 14 divided by 2 is 7. 7 times 188 is, survey says, 1,316. So if you ate 42 there, and then whatever it was there, I don't know what the next numbers are, but I know that by the time I get to the end and I eat the 146 at the end, I've eaten 1,316 flies. Woohoo! All right. You didn't need to know all the numbers, but you didn't even need to know the step size, because this formula doesn't require the step size. Sneaky, eh? All right. Now I'll show you where I got that formula. All right. Now technically you don't need to know this. All right. So if I want to do something, here's a demonstration. It's not exactly a proof, because it doesn't work for all numbers necessarily. But I'm going to show you that it works for these numbers. 1 plus 2 plus 3 all the way up to 10. I'm going to tell you what the sum of that is. All right. So the way I'm going to calculate that is I'm going to say I'm going to take those numbers and I'm going to add them to themselves. So you go, well, that's a crazy thing to do. You go, well, no, it isn't, because now I got two sums. Right? If I add them together, don't I have two sums? Right. So my two sums add up to, what do they add up to? Well, don't I have 10 elevens? Look, I got an 11 and an 11 and an 11 and an 11. And I got 10 elevens. Well, that's 10 elevens. So it's 110 divided by 2. Because I wanted to know what one sum was. So it turns out it's 55. So that's why that n over 2 times the first and the last add up. Because look, first and last, first and last, first and last, first and last. So you take the first and the last like that. That's why it works. You don't need to know that. But I wanted you to see why that formula worked. It worked pretty well there. It works pretty well here. It works for 1 to 10. It works for any arithmetic series. All right, let's try this one. So you got $20 the first day, and then I pay you $30 the next day to come to class, and then $40, and then the next day I pay you $50, and I do that for, well, let's see, I'm paying you to come to class, so I do that for 15 days. All right, so how much money do you have if I gave you $30, $20 the first day, $30 the next day, $40, $50? If I keep upping your daily pay by $10, how much money would you have? Well, you got a general formula for this. It's that. Now, of course, that's not going to work right off the get-go, because you know what your first day was, but you don't know what your last day is. Well, you could figure it out using the explicit formula. Well, so let's try it this way. You got another formula. Try that. So you got another formula that does the sum of an arithmetic series. It's 2a's plus n less 1 times the d. Well, you got the d. You can see the d is 10. You know that the n is 15. So you know everything you need to know. You just plug in all the numbers. You know the N, you know the A, you know the N, you know the D. Boom. Hit a few buttons on your calculator, and the survey will come, answer will come out of the calculator. And I notice some of you don't have very good calculator skills. You might want to work on that. All right, so here comes the answer. It ends up being 1,350. So if you come to school and I pay you $20 the first day, $30 the next day, $40, $50, if I keep giving you an extra $10 every day, by the end of the 15 days of classes, you'll have earned $1,350 total. That will be your sum. All right. Now, how did I get that weird formula? Check this out. All right, it turns out that I can make lots of formulas. I tell you the basic facts. If you want to combine them and make other formulas, it's possible. Right? So I demonstrated where that came from. By the way, you don't need to know this, but I want to show you this. All right? So I showed you where that formula comes from. I proved it while I demonstrated it to you. All right? And, hey, you got another formula. You got the formula that says your last term, your Tn, is your first term plus n minus 1 times d. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to combine the two formulas. Here's the sum formula. Here's the last term formula explicitly. I'm going to take this, and so your last is that. So wherever I see an L, I'm going to plug that in. This is called combining two formulas. So you do that. Now, do you agree that an A plus an A is really two A's? There you go. Does that formula look familiar? Sure it does. So really, this formula and this formula were really the same thing. All you did was you combine these two to come up with that. So knowing this formula is all you really need to know. Coming up with all kinds of other fancy formulas, I mean, you can come up with a lot of fancy formulas, but all you got to do is know the two basic ones, and then you can figure out all the others yourself if it was necessary. So this one here was really overkill, really, wasn't it? All you really needed to know was this one in the beginning. And this one, of course. All right, but you don't need to know that. That is advanced stuff. Next slide. All right, so I made a boo-boo on this one. That first term, that nth term should be 118. All right. So this says now you've got a bunch of lily pads. You're not sure how many lily pads you have, right? I'm drawing them for you. Draw the freaking thing out. All right, you draw it out. Make some lily pads, leave some blanks if you have to. And you know the first lily pad has 19 flies, and you know the last lily pad has 96. You just don't know how many lily pads are in between. And you know that when you get to the, by the time you get to there, you've eaten 822 flies. So there's a 19, right? And this is actually 118, by the way, right? We'll fix that in a second. And you know that all equals 822. So now this is the beauty of showing your work. Notice I told you that I put the wrong number there when I did up the exercise. That should be 118. But by showing your work a little bit, it's easy to go back and correct any boo-boos that the teacher made. Right? So we're going to follow the formula. The formula is right n over 2 times the sum of the first and the last. That's general. Let's plug it in. 19 plus 96. Yep, we know the n. We don't. Yep, we know the n. We know the n is, we don't know the n, do we? So it's going to be 19 plus 90. Oh, no, they told you the last term was 118. So we know the first, we know the last, we know the sum. And I did all that math. It turns out that I'm using the wrong numbers, right? And we ended up with some, if you do this math, it ends up the n is 11.4 or something silly. It's not going to work. That's when I realized, oh, I must have screwed this up. And I checked the exercise, and yes, I had transcribed it wrong. So notice now I'm going to go back and fix it. So wherever I had a 96 becomes a 118. So that's the advantage of showing your work kind of neatly, is you can always go back and tweak things. I don't have to take an eraser and erase everything. Right now I know that's a 118. So all I got to do is change a few things that were messed up. All right, I don't have to restart all over again. Right, so I divide by the 137 and multiply by the 2. Turns out when you do that math, you end up with the n is 12. All right, so this was really 118. 118. 118. Right, so when you do the math, it ends up being 12. Do the math, he says. Next slide. All right, let's try this one. Now you're told your first term is negative 3. Your common difference is 2. And your sum of all your numbers is 21. Well, you could sort of do this with all the fancy formulas. So you start with a negative 3 on a lily pad, and then you got some number of lily pads, and you don't know. And you know that each lily pad goes up by 2, and you know when you add up all the lily pads, it ends up being 21. I call them lily pads because I'm picturing it like a froggy. All right, so you're trying to figure out, so you can sort of figure out, so this is going to be like negative 1, positive 1, positive 3. You're going to keep going up by 2 until the sum, what's it going to be? Well, we only got a couple formulas, so you know you got this formula. Right, so we got a formula that tells you the sum if you know the N and the A and the N and the D. Well, let's see. You told us the sum, and we don't know the N, but we do know the A, and we still don't know the N, but we do know the D. Hey, I know everything in here. I know the D, the A, and the S. It's only the N I don't know. So you can actually calculate this. All right, so you're going to go like this. Now, of course, you're going to find there's a problem here. So you're going to go like this. Right, notice I got rid of this 2 just by doubling, multiplying by 2. And you bring it inside like that, and you end up with that. And I screwed it up there. So you end up with that. Now, it turns out you're going to end up with an N times an N. You're going to end up with a quadratic expression if you multiply this together. It turns out that is unit A stuff. I forgot. It used to be that I taught the unit A stuff before I taught the unit D stuff, but I noticed that you guys were kind of wigging out on quadratics, so I thought I'd do it in a different order. Anyway, it's not that tough. Here's what we will learn. All right. So it turns out that's the seventh lily pad. Right? It turns out the ints are 7. You could have guessed. But here, I'll show you how you do it. But this is unit A. You don't technically know how to do this. So remember we said that 42 equals negative 8n plus 2n squared. Right? Let's see that. 42 equals n to, right? Negative 8n plus 2n's. So when you multiply this out, this will be negative 8n's plus 2n squared. Right? So right there. So that's what you'll have, negative 8n plus 2n squared. Now what you do, this is unit A stuff. We haven't done it. So I'm going to divide by 2, make it simpler. All right, divide everything by 2. I'm going to factor it. Remember how to factor? All right. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to bring this over to this side by subtracting. I'm going to make everything equal to 0. Then I'm going to factor. Now this is unit A stuff, so don't wig out on me. All right. So I'm going to factor it out. Do you believe that n minus 7 times n plus 3 would give you that? N squared. Take away 7 n's, add 3 n's. That's a take away 4 n's. And negative 7 times 3 is negative. So that's true. So when they factor it, it says that all of that multiplied together is 0. And you go, well, there's only two ways that can happen. If the n was 0, then this would be 3. But it wouldn't matter because this would be 0 times 3 is 0. Or if the n was negative 3, because a negative 3 plus a 3 would be 0. And this would be negative 10, so you'd have 0 times negative 10 is still 0. So it turns out those two answers, 7 and negative 3. This is unit A stuff. We have not yet done unit A. Don't wig out. I apologize for giving you this question. There was only one. You could have guessed and got the answer too. So it turns out that it turns out 7 makes sense. How can you have negative 3 lily pads? That wouldn't make sense. So we call that that's called extraneous. It's called an answer what doesn't make sense. So it turns out the answer is 7. So it turns out in this problem there was 7 lily pads, and if you added them all up, it'd be 21. All right? But that involved knowing something that we haven't learned, how to solve a quadratic equation, which we have not learned. Sorry about that. All right. Anyway, now you know. All right. Let's find the nth term of this. All right. Find the nth term. Where is it there? Find the nth term of the geometric series. All right. So they tell you what the sixth term is this time. And they want to know the second term. So they tell you the sixth term is 3. And they tell you the R is 2. We tell you the R is 2. And we tell you we want to know what term 2 is. So how do you do that? Well, let's have a look here. This one doesn't take a lot of fancy formulas. This takes a little bit more thinking, recursively maybe. A little recursive thinking is probably the smart way to do this. Right? Sometimes the simple is the best, seriously. No need to get fancy if it's unnecessary. So you're told term 6 is 3, and you're asked, since this is geometric series, what is the second term, given that the R is 2. All right, so let's see. The R is 2. That means that whatever was here when you multiplied it by 2 gave you a 3. All right? So that lets you figure out that that must be a 3 halves, because 3 halves times 2 would give you 3. In other words, 3 times 1 half would give you 3 halves. So going this way, it's called doubling. Going this way, it's called halving. So in other words, going this way, you multiply by 2, Going backwards, you multiply by 1/2 or divide by 2. So we're going to divide by 2 again. Multiply by 1/2. Won't that be 3/4? Let's multiply by 1/2. Let's take another step to the left. Multiply by 1/2. Let's take another step to the left. Multiply by 1/2. Gee, I'm pretty good at multiplying by 1/2. I just keep doubling the denominator. So it turns out that there is your second term. So like I was saying, notice that when you go to the right, you're doubling, and when you're going back to the left, you're halving, or multiplying by 1/2. Right, so there's how I figured it out. I just sort of did it recursively. I only had to go back 4 terms. I didn't get into fancy formulas. I could have, but who wants to do 1/2 raised to the 4 or something silly like that? All right, so I like this one too. What's this one say? Carry on. Let's go back. Animate. So this is question 5. These are just ones I selected off of the whole potpourri of assignments I gave you. I said you end up with 354,294. All right. So somehow or other, you add up these numbers, and you end up with 354,294. So I'm asking you for what is the n? So how many numbers did you add up so that you got to 354,294? Right. So you notice right away. How many terms do you have? So what is the n? Well, you notice right away that your r is 3, because every step to the right, you triple the next number. So how many triplings do you have to do to get to 354,294? Well, the formula is you take your first term, and then you multiply it by the number of triplings you have to do. So, of course, that's an n minus 1, because you didn't triple on your first lily pad. It was just already there. Right, so there's your general formula to calculate any term in a geometric series given the first term. So, well, we know what the nth term is. We know that it has to be that. We just don't know what the n is. So we don't know how many lily pads there were to get to there. All right, so I'm going to tidy this up. Right, so we got that right there. So I'm going to tidy this up by dividing by 2. All right, so you end up with 3 raised to the n minus 1 is 177,147. All right, now, there is a button on a calculator that does this sort of thing. It's pretty common. It's called the log button. Anytime you want to solve an exponent, it involves a log button. That's grade 12. But you know it's going to be something pretty simple, right? You know that it's going to be, 10, 12, 15. Remember doing Uncle Leo? And when he doubled your pay every day, you ended up getting like $20,000. Well, now you're tripling your pay every day. So you're going to get up to big numbers pretty quick. It's not going to be that all big a number. So let's just try trial and error. All right. So 3 to the 3 is 27. All right. Get out your calculator if you don't know how to do that. 3 to the 4 is, isn't that 9 nines, 81. 3 to the, let's jump a few because we're not very close yet. 3 to the 6 is going to be 81 times another 9 is 729. All right, so you're saying, well, we're not close yet. Let's try 3 to the 10. Let's jump a few. 3 to the 10 is, now you need your calculator, 59,049. Hey, I think we got it. It turns out that 3 to the 11th is going to be, 3 times that is 177,147. So it didn't take us long to guess the answer. So it turns out that at 11, so if your n minus 1 is 11, then you get the answer. So n minus 1 is 11. So if your answer, less 1, is 11, doesn't that mean your n itself is 12? Because 12 minus 1 would be 11, which would give you that. All right, so you didn't need any fancy mathematics to do that. This is real math when you see those patterns. So it turns out this is the 12th term. So the 12th term following that pattern and then adding them all together is going to equal, right? I should have showed that it was a series with addings in there. If you were to add up all those things by the time you got to the end. Oh, I'm sorry, we weren't adding them, were we? We were just trying to find the nth term. So disregard the adding bit. We weren't adding anything, were we? We were just trying to find the nth term. All right, so it turns out that's how I found how many terms it took to get to that value. Next slide. Find the geometric means. Now, I think I don't know if I explained this in the notes, but we'll do it now. So, of course, you know what a mean is, right? You call a mean an average. And, of course, the way you find an average is you take your two marks. You had an 80 and you had a 90, and you add them together and you divide by 2, and you say, oh, my average mark is 85. And we actually call that an arithmetic mean. If you do, instead of an average, we call that an arithmetic mean when you do proper statistics. So you'd say the number in between is 85, right? So you just found a number in between. That's called a mean. Now, you're used to finding the one number in between. But you know what? Sometimes there's more than one number in between. You want to set it up. And there's more than arithmetic means, by the way. You can do other types of means. So I'm looking for what number goes there, and what number goes there, and what number goes there, so they make a consistent geometric pattern. Can you see what it is? Isn't this negative 3? Because this would be negative 3, and then multiply by negative 3 and make positive 9, and then multiply by negative 3 and make negative 27. Can you see that's what it would be? Yeah, if not, that's fine. But you could monkey around and guess it after 20 minutes, I suppose. Right, trial and error is a good way of doing things for a while. However, we do know that the nth term is this explicit formula, the first term times the common ratio raised to the n less 1. So the term 4 is 1 times the common ratio raised to the, well, this is the fourth term, so you got to raise it to the 3. And we know what the fourth term was. It was negative 27. So negative 27 is a 1 that's been multiplied by the r 3 times. So negative 27 is r cubed. R, how do you do that? Well, that's called doing a cube root, not a square root. You got a cube root button on your calculator, if you know where to find it. Normally, I don't know where to find the cube root button on a calculator because they move it all over the place. Do you remember that a cube root is really the same as a one-third exponent? I prefer to do things as exponents. So now you got to remember your grade 10 exponents. All right, turns out that it's going to be, if you type this into your calculator, negative 27 y to the x, and then raise it to the one-third. That's the way I do it. And of course, you use a hat on a good calculator. Turns out the answer is negative 3. Your plastic brain will tell you that the cube root of negative 27 is negative 3, because negative 3 times negative 3 times negative 3 is negative 27. So you could have figured that. You knew it had to be something. Well, you didn't know it had to be something nice. It could have been something nastier. It wasn't too bad. All right, so there's how that works. Next slide. Oh, this one's fun. All right, so I give you these terms here. And we're still doing geometrics here, I think. Yep. Oh, yeah. So I pretty much want to know all the other terms in there. You're finding the means. Find the missing things in between and at the beginning. All right? That's what a mean is. You're just used to averages like arithmetic averages. There are other types of means. So let's see. The only clue I got is somehow I took 1, 2, right, I took 1, 2 steps to get to 27 halves. So I took a 6, and somehow I multiplied it by an r 2 times to get to 27 halves. So I wonder what that r is. So I divide by 6, so that's 27 twelfths. So 27 twelfths is really what some people call 9 fourths. So I multiplied by r 2 times to get 9 fourths. So r squared is 9 fourths. What's just a 1 r? Well, isn't that called unsquaring? Don't you do the square root of both sides? What's the square root of 9? 3. What's the square root of 4? 2. There you go. It turns out that the secret r to go from there to there is 3 halves. All right. Turns out that it's 3 halves, so it's going to be 6, 9, 27 halves. So you go from 6 to 9, multiplying by 1 and a half. Right, 1.5. And then you multiply 9 by 1.5 again, 18 halves, and you get 27 halves, which is called 13.5. And it does work, right? 18 halves times 3 halves is going to be 54 fourths, which is 27 twofths. 27 halves. It does work. This times 3 halves gives 18 halves. This times 3 halves gives 54 fourths, which is 27 halves. Stop the video and check if you don't trust me. All right. Somebody didn't trust me. Let's just check. I proved to you that 18 halves . So if you're going this way, you're multiplying by 3 halves. If you're going this way, you're dividing by 3 halves, which is the same as multiplying by 2 thirds. So somebody didn't believe me that 18 halves times 3 halves was 54 sixths. So I had to show you that 54 fourths, and 54 fourths is the same as 27 halves. Right, so it turns out that you just keep multiplying by 2 thirds. So going this way, you multiply by 3 halves. Going this way, you divide by 3 halves, which is the same as multiplying by 2 thirds. So 2 thirds of 6 is 4. 2 thirds of 4 is 8 thirds, or 2 and 2 thirds for some of you. And of course, there's this one in here as well, which we didn't calculate. There's the idea behind it. So it's all about knowing how many steps you took to calculate your R. Let's calculate the convergence of this thing. Let's see if this sums up to something. All right, so we got 2 over 9 plus 5 over 27 plus 25 over 162 plus, plus, plus. We're adding a bunch of stuff together, and we want to find the, what are we finding here? Find the infinite sum. So we're going to take this series of geometric terms in a geometric sequence, and we're going to add them together to make a series, and we're going to do it forever. Okay, so what is the R? Well, in order to use our formulas, we need to know the R. So do you remember how to find the R? Let's look at the recursive idea. Right, the recursive idea was, if you want to know any particular term, you take the term before it, the n minus 1th term, and you multiply it by the R. Well, that makes sense. Which means, if you know those two things, you can calculate the R, because you're going to divide by the... So you're going to take any term and divide it by the one before it, and that will tell you what the R was to get the term. So 5 27ths divided by 2 ninths. All right, now this is where you better know your fractions. So 5 27ths divided by 2 ninths. Well, isn't that 5 27ths times 9 halves? Because you flip and multiply, so that's going to be, let's see, turn that into 1 over 3, so that's 5 over 3, that's going to be 5 over 6. So it turns out your R is 5 sixths. To go from there to there, you multiply by 5 sixths. So the R is 5 sixths, check it out. If I multiply 2 ninths by 5 sixths, don't I get 10 54ths? Well, isn't 10 54ths the same as 5 27ths? If I take 5 27ths and multiply it by 5 sixths, don't I get 25 6 27ths? 6 27ths. 6 20s is 120, and another 42 is 162. Well, yeah, so it does work. Multiplying by 5 sixths does the job. So you know the R. Now you got to plug it into your formula. Your infinite sum is pretty easy. It's the first term divided by 1 minus the R. And of course, I think I've got it right here. So it's 2 ninths divided by 1 minus 5 sixths. So it's 2 ninths divided by 1 sixth, which is really 2 ninths times 6. So anyway, it turns out that when you do all that math, I might have missed some there, I just took a phone call, right? When you do all that math, here we go. So it's the first term, which is 2 ninths, all divided by 1 subtract 5 sixths, which is really 1 sixth. So 2 ninths divided by 1 sixth is really the same as 2 ninths times 6 onths, which is really 12 ninths, which most people call 4 thirds. Alright, turns out the answer is 4 thirds. So if you added up all those numbers forever, which takes a little while, you'll end up with 1.3 4 thirds. Whew, that was good. Next slide. What's the infinite sum of this? So you got your A is 50. So you start with your first term of 50, and you keep, every time you jump one lily pad to the right, you get 2/5 as many flies. Alright, so you're going to start with 50, then you'll get 20. I like to draw it out. And then you're going to get 8, right? 2 times 20 is 40, divided by 5 is 8. And then, of course, you're going to get, 16 fifths? Right? 5 and a third for some of you. And then you just keep following that pattern. 32, 20 fifths, etc. So it turns out that I want to know what happens if you keep adding and adding and adding. Notice you can use the infinite sum series. This is an adding because it's a sum, it's a series. Anytime this is between 1 and negative 1, as long as it's less than 1, it will converge to an answer. So you can use the infinite sum. If that's more than 1, of course, it'll just get bigger and bigger and bigger, and it'll never go to one answer. But if it's less than 1, it'll eventually just start becoming so tiny, the little extra bits, that it just converges on a final answer. So anyway, you end up with 50 divided by 1 minus 2 fifths, and of course, 1 minus 2 fifths is 3 fifths. So 50 over 3 fifths is, flip and multiply, 50 times 5 thirds, 250 thirds. So what is that? That's like 83 and a third for some of you, right? It's 83 and a third. But I just call it 250 thirds. Let's do one of these summation things. So this says add up a bunch of stuff. All right, we'll start with an index k of 1, and we're going to add up 35 things. And how do you calculate these things? You go 2 times the number plus 3. All right, so I'm going to draw a picture. I got 35 lily pads here. I start at lily pad 1, and I go up to lily pad 35. And the way I calculate what I'm doing is I take 2 times the K, so 2 times the lily pad number 1, 2 1s plus 3 is 5. And then the next one's going to be 2 times 2 plus 3 is 5. And then, of course, every time I take one step to the right, every time I increase this K by 1 until I get to 35, every time I increase this K by 1, doesn't that add an extra 2? So since increasing the K by 1 adds an extra 2, you're really just adding 2 every time. Every step is going to add 2. All right, so let's just do that math. I'm not going to write them all down. I don't feel like writing down 35 numbers. But you know you end up with 73, don't you? Look, 2 times 35 is 70 plus 3, 73. So you know the first number, you know the last number, you know the number of terms. Gee, I think we have a formula that does that. We have a formula that has the first, the last, and the number of terms in it. I like it. So you do the math. Famous last words. Do the math. 35 times 39. 1,365 is the final answer. And then I gave you a quiz. This was a pretty complicated quiz, wasn't it? I knew I'd worked you pretty hard, so I thought I'd give you a one-question quiz that everybody gets 100% on. I had to help a couple people a little bit. This was geometric. Some of you tried to do an arithmetic sum to a geometric sequence. Of course, that doesn't work too well. All right, then we had some after-class fun. And who wanted to do... Oh, Cheryl and some folks were doing this. All right, so it turns out... Well, here, it's the same thing as we just did. I'll race through this. I got to get home, do some curling. Notice you subtract 3 every time, right? You're adding 3 every time. That's what this 3 is telling you. Every time this I, this index, every time your I goes up by 1, doesn't it give you an extra 3? So it means you're going to be adding 3 each time. So you start at 3 1s, which is 1, minus 13. So you start at negative 10, and then you go up by 3, up by 3. Up by 3, up by 3, until you go up to your 35th lily pad. Your 35th lily pad is going to be 92, isn't it? It's going to be lily pad 35 times 3. 35 times 3, 105 minus 13, 92. Gee, you got a formula that does that. First and the last times the terms divided by 2. 1,435. These are all extracted from your assignment, by the way. The sum of the numbers from... Oh, this is easy. You've only got... How many there? You've only got 5 terms being added together. Right? It goes from term 2 to term 6. I didn't start at term 1. So I've got 6 minus 2 is 4, plus the one that I started with. There's 5 terms there. Count them. Look. Term 2, term 3, term 4, term 5, term 6. You got to remember that... Right? You got to count the one you're at. So we're going to add them together, adding them together. Nobody says you have to start counting at term one, right? Maybe this is the money you're going to get paid on day two, day three, day four, day five, and day six for something, and you already spent day one's money. So sometimes you don't care about day one because you already spent it, right? So we're going to start counting at day two. All right, so it turns out you got six. Oh, you don't have six terms. You got five terms. Look at what I did. It's five terms. Six minus two plus one is five. So look, I think I corrected this later. I did, didn't I? That wasn't really a six. That's not a six. It's a five. There's only five terms when you do that. So I was misled too. All right, so it turns out that's a five. So the sum of the five terms when you start on day two, not on day one. That's the problem with these ones. You got to be careful that you don't start at day one. So there was five terms. Right, there's the right answer. Check it out. Right, there's 15, 27, 42, and 18 makes 60. You could have done that yourself. Right, it is 60. Just add them up. And, okay, then we did some logarithms with some folks, and we did some more logarithms for people who wanted to know how to unexponent things. I think that's it. Briefing complete.